Good morning. Welcome to worship here at Port Elgin United Church. I'm the Reverend Dan Lever, and I'm delighted to be your minister as we live into a mission of sharing God's word into this world guided by the Holy Spirit. Friends, whether you're a longtime member, a newer-ish person, or a visitor here for Pumpkin Fest, I welcome you and I hope there's something for you this morning. This morning, leading in worship with me, we have Nancy and the worship team giving us the gift of music, as well as Susan and Anne offering us a lovely duet. June will be sharing us with the scripture reading this morning. Louise has one child so far for Discovery Cove. And we have Dan and Aiden rocking the AV team, making sure those at home can see and hear and join us that way. So thank you all for your participation and leadership in our worship service this morning. This morning is Worldwide Communion. That is exactly what it sounds like. Everyone across the world, or every Christian across the world, is celebrating in this sacred meal. So we will participate in it this morning. So those at home and join us online, hit pause, run, go grab some grape juice and some bread, and run back and hit unpause. I have a few more announcements. No one came to me. I just want to see if there's anyone that has announcements. Penny has an announcement. Very good. Welcome back, Penny. I think you're back for a week, but I was away for a week.
Greetings. I've missed you for a month, and you've missed me. Okay. Coat drive is going spectacularly. Don't feel that you cannot still bring coats or boots. Anyone that's listening on TV or however you're listening, we have two bins out the front of the church in a covered area if you want to drop off coats or boots, whatever winter wear you have, we'd be delighted to have it. And if you know a family or someone who could use a free coat or boots, we will be distributing the coats on Friday, October 18th. So that date is coming. So if you know someone, please spread the word, and we'll do our best to get coats to everyone that needs them. And any leftover coats will be available for either food banks or schools or any organization that has a way to distribute coats throughout the winter. So please contact the office and let them know that you would like to have some coats that are left over. Thank you very much.
I have a few more announcements to offer. A reminder that our covenanting service, this is a covenant, a promise, an agreement with myself, you, the congregation, and Western Ontario Waterways Regional Council, our United Church Council Governance Model. It is October 20th at 2 in the afternoon right here. I have my friend coming in from London to be the guest preacher. He is a lovely person. I invite you to appreciate, if not for the promise we need to make with one another, enjoy his sermon. That's the Covenant Service, October 20th at 2 p.m. In the directory, if you saw that, there's two things I want to pull out of that. One, my Friday file, I speak of new beginnings. As we enter into this covenanted relationship in this month, I want to get to know you more, and I want you to get to know me more. Outside of committee meetings, outside of our conversations during coffee time, I want to sit with you and chat and learn your history and for you to learn my history. So to answer a question that was asked me already this morning, if I see you every week, do I really need to do this? Yes, I would love to. I want to. I have plans to learn who you are, for us to build in this relationship, to understand what we were wanting to do in this ministry, and to build that love and trust and friendship. So yes, Susan is helping me with the sign up. It is an online form. If you struggle with that, if you know who Susan Brown is, speak to her. She can help you out, including she's going to have her computer set up by the Activity Center to help those get registered and signed up. There's already, I think, six people that signed up Friday when they received the Friday file. Secondly, and this couples with it fairly well, we're getting a new directory. We have dates set for a new directory in our directory photos for November 6th to 9th. And again, it is online registrations. Friday file has the link. If you struggle with that, I think there's someone in charge to make sure you get help. If not, call the office and Michelle and I will figure that out for you. So if you want a new photo, be in our directory and a new photo to put up on the wall or to give your family, sign up. The dates, again, first week of November. As we, before we move into our worship time, but also a bit of an announcement, I feel I need to address that tomorrow marks a one-year anniversary of the escalated violence in Israel, Gaza, West Bank, and East Israel. It's been 1 year tomorrow since things got really, really horrific. So the United Church of Canada has provided a statement for us during this difficult anniversary, and I am going to share with you just a little bit of what the United Church is offering. Broken, grieving, sometimes confused, often afraid, and complicit, we struggle to know how to respond. Today, so tomorrow, marks 1 year since the horrific escalation of violence in Israel, Gaza, the West Bank, and East Jerusalem. Over the last several days, we have witnessed escalation of violence in the region with attacks on Lebanon and from Iran to Israel. As a church, we know the power of gathering in community in prayer and in action, and so we continue to pray and act for just peace in the region. Scripture tells us God requires us to do justice. The United Church's commitment to the gospel of Jesus Christ and to solidarity with Palestinians and Israeli partners demands that we find the courage to do justice, seek for right relations, stand with oppressed, speak truth to power, especially when it is costly, and uphold dignity of all people who are all God's creation. The full statement I will offer this week through our Friday file email list as well as our Facebook page, as well as tomorrow I'm going to offer a brief prayer and liturgy in this difficult anniversary, time of anniversary. I will record it and share it with you virtually as well. And as we continue and work towards our aspects of reconciliation, we take a moment to acknowledge that we are gathered on the traditional lands and treaty territories of the Saugeen Ojibwe Nation, which consists of the Chippewas of Saugeen and the Chippewas of Nawash, unceded First Nations. This land, since time immemorial, has been home to the people of the Saugeen Ojibwe Nation, and we are respectful and grateful for the opportunity to live and work alongside these indigenous people of this land as we commit ourselves to being better stewards in relationship with creation, as we commit ourselves to righting relations with the indigenous peoples. This past week on Monday, September 30th, 6 days ago, was the National Day of Truth and Reconciliation. Many wore orange shirts, went out to events to learn and honor Indigenous history and culture, and took time and personal reflection on our role in reconciliation. Just because there's one day dedicated to doesn't mean we stop on that one day. And so I offer this broad view. The United Church of Canada's magazine shared an article this week during this time by Reverend Tony Snow entitled, "This is What is Missing from Land Acknowledgements." It was published in March 2023, and I wish to share some of Tony's thoughts. "I've traveled across the country and heard land acknowledgements being offered as part of the United Church worship services and gatherings. I see many communities of faith trying to get it right by consulting with Indigenous knowledge keepers. Just know that there is no absolute right way to do a land acknowledgement. It is a developing protocol. As understanding grows, practice improves. Land acknowledgements are an attempt to draw historical relationships into intercultural dialogue in order to decolonize assumptions about ownership and place. They are entry points into relationship with Indigenous neighbors and meant to facilitate engagement. Many acknowledgments falter when people are nebulous about with whom they are building the relationship with. Many acknowledgments list a consortium of historical stewards, keeping the relationship strictly in the past. Others move quickly to recognize or contrition of forepast wrongs. But very few speak of a close personal connection to the people of the land and to the historical basis of their relationship with Indigenous neighbors through this treaty promises and covenant. My invitation for you in sharing these words of Tony is for you to reflect on how our land acknowledgement is written and received. Are we encouraged by Tony's words? Are we challenged by Tony's words? How can we change the land acknowledgement or ourselves to live into these words of reconciliation? So I offer those as we ask these questions because we as a community of faith within the larger body of the United Church of Canada continue to deepen our understanding of our denominational past, present, and future relationships with our Indigenous siblings across Turtle Island and all our relations. We light our Christ candle to remind us that when two or more are gathered, Christ is with us. The Spirit is amongst us. And when we sing and pray and laugh and cry together, that is a holy moment. Friends, the light of Christ. Let's take a few moments to prepare our hearts for worship. Around the globe, God's people gather this day on World Communion Sunday. We gather around the Lord's table. We gather with different languages. We gather with difference to numbers to count. Yet we are more the same than different. Created in the image of God, we are in the name good and treasured by our Creator. Let us worship in unity, peace, and joy. Holy is our God. Blessed are we who are in the presence in our God. Friends, let us pray. Loving God, we draw near to you and to others in faith. We come remembering the taste of bread and wine. We come remembering the freedom of forgiveness and the strength of your presence. Draw us nearer to you. Help us to know our lives start from faith and end in faith. Amen. Friends, the peace of Christ be with you. Please turn to your friends and neighbors and offer signs of peace. Thank you. work your way to getting settled. Let's bring our voices together with Jesus Loves Me. Good morning. I'm glad you made it through the rain. Did any of you go to Pumpkin Fest yesterday? Yeah. Was it like one, two, or three thumbs up? Two thumbs up? Three? Oh, three. There was a foot. Okay. Three thumbs. That's how good it was. I heard some exciting news around the largest pumpkin being not quite, but almost 2,000 pounds, if I remember correctly. What an exciting time. I was there yesterday for the first time in 20 years, and it was quite the crowd, a lovely day. Nonetheless, I have a question for you. My question, can plants take care of themselves? Yes, they can. Anyone else got a thought? Kind of not. Tell me more. How can a plant take care of itself? Yeah. Love gets that loving sunshine and that loving rain like we got this morning. What do you, Mac, you had a couple of thoughts. You said sort of, like yes and no. What's, tell me more about the no side. Can a plant take care of itself? It can. From nature. Okay, let me adjust this a little bit. How about a house plant? Can a house plant? I meant to bring my house plant from home and I forgot because it's a lovely plant and it also has some brown spots on it because we're not good at caring for plants. Can a house plant take care of itself that well? No. What does the house plant rely on? Air to breathe. What's that fancy word for? Photosynthesis, thank you. Relies on photosynthesis. Water. Someone needs to kind of do the watering, do some of the pruning. It doesn't prune itself. It needs to be cared for. A lot of plants, like the one I have at home, you got to be very careful. You got to not water it too much, but not water it enough. Wait, that wasn't the right words. If you water it too much, it doesn't do well. If you don't water enough, it doesn't do well. And you got to be very careful. And that plant really relies on us. It's very, there's a big word that starts with a V that I'm thinking of. It's a very vulnerable plant because it needs others to care for it. Now, fortunately, we have some lovely fake plants. Now, they don't need too much care, but every once in a while you should fake water your fake plants just to be sure. thank you. Wonderful. Vulnerable. Like God, Jesus calls us to care for those who can't care for themselves, the vulnerable. And often, sometimes, that's us once in a while or all the time. We all have something that we need cared for, and God and our friends can help us know and engage and learn from that. So before I send you off with Louise to Discovery Cove, we're going to bless the congregation. So we do this by standing up. We look at the congregation. We find an adult. We look them deep in the eyes. And children, I want you to say so loud, my mom can hear you on YouTube. Repeat after me, kids. May God bless you. As you stay to hear God's word. Adults, may God bless you as you go to hear God's word. Thank you so much. Joy.
I'm glad to be back. And I want to take just a moment to thank everyone for all of the good wishes, the cards, the phone calls, the food. It was wonderful. Thank you so much. So I'm coming along slowly but surely. The scripture reading this morning is taken from Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 to 4. God has spoken by his Son. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by a Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being, and he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. The second reading is from Hebrews chapter 2, verses 5 to 12. Exaltation through abasement. Now God did not subject the coming world, about which we are speaking, to angels. But someone has testified somewhere, "What are humans that you are mindful of them, or mortals that you care for them? You have made them for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned them with glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet. Now in subjecting all things to them, God left nothing outside their control. As it is, we do not yet see everything in subjection to them, but we do see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. Our final reading this morning is taken from Mark chapter 10, verses 2 to 16. Some, testing him, asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" He answered them, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her." But Jesus said to them, "Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of creation, God made male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. Then in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. He said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." And then Jesus blesses little children. People were bringing children to him in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the children come to me. Do not stop them. For it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly, I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. This is the word of the Lord.
Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, my rock and my redeemer. Wowzers! Those are some difficult words from Jesus about marriage. And then we jump right into this loving image of the children coming and being blessed by him. It is easy to want to ignore or skip over that first part of that gospel reading and go right to the lovey-dovey Jesus caring for the children and blessing them. Jesus loves all the children of the world. However, in my studies, my living, and my working in community, I've come to acknowledge the need to be aware of the difficult topics, subjects, or tensions. In fact, it was this epiphany of living in those tensions came during yoga lectionary. Yes, that sounds exactly what it sounds like. It is exactly what it sounds like. We would do yoga with a diaconal minister, and we would reflect on the week's lectionary readings. It was in one of our first sessions, while we're in a position, she said, "Notice the tension. Don't lean in, don't lean away. Notice it. Sit in that tension. Stay there." When I hear these words of marriage and divorce from Jesus, many may want to pull away from that tension, or may want to pull away from that tension as it causes us to feel uncomfortable or guilty. But I invite you to explore, reflect, and engage at tension from these holy scriptures. One of these threads that tie these two stories that are very jarringly different from the marriage and divorce to the children coming to Jesus, it's about that word I said with the kids this morning, vulnerability. Jesus is talking about the most vulnerable in society. This first century Greco-Roman society that Jesus lived in, women had no status, and being married was their social and economic security, her connection to the family, her husband, and her stability. Being divorced, being kicked out from that network connection and security would be devastating, as the woman would lose everything. I am not old enough to remember or know of the creation and evolution of the Family Law Reform Act for divorce that started in the late 60s, continued into the 70s and 80s, and has always been fine-tuned as we've gone. But a colleague of mine brought it to my attention as we were discussing and wrestling with this Scripture. Ultimately, as I understand, originally if there was a divorce, the wife would, and likely the children, would just get nothing, would be left alone and be incredibly vulnerable in society. The reform was to include parameters to allow some security and independence for those young people and the wife. Jesus is speaking about how we are to treat all persons and support the most vulnerable in our society. This is why there is such a strange jump from this lesson of divorce into the children coming to Jesus and being blessed by him. Again, this first century Greco-Roman Empire that Jesus walked in, lived in, and did his ministry in, did not have the same blissfulness of Victorian childhood that we have either experienced or witnessed. Children were considered less than, had no status or value in the community. This is possibly why the disciples tried to prevent the children to come up to Jesus, prevent the children from being brought to Jesus that he might touch them. That touch was actually something else that popped up in my mind when I read these scriptures this week. The act of touching was actually one of the things that caught my attention. And it's because the children were being brought and they wanted the children to be touched by Jesus. Where else in the Bible do we hear about Jesus touching and what happens in those moments? It's in healing. A lot of the healing stories of Jesus is about touching persons. Jesus healing Peter, Simon's mother. Jesus healing the leopard, the hemorrhaged woman who reached out and touched his cloak. Jesus healing a blind man and the deaf mute with dirt and spit. These all involve Jesus touching the person in that act of healing. Where was I? So that has me wondering, were these children not just children less vulnerable, but also sick? Were they not well? And that's why there was a drive to push them to be touched by Jesus. This double whammy of vulnerability, not just children, but also the sick, because they outcast those who were sick. The disciples may have been preventing these children for that exact reason. The children had no significance or importance for Jesus' attention, in the disciples' opinion. This could be why Jesus was so indignant. What a great word, indignant. Jesus, having taught, blessed, healed many people with the disciples present, how were the disciples still not getting that message? Let all come, let all be with, let all be touched, let all experience Jesus' love and healing power and blessing. They keep missing that notion that Jesus was there to welcome the sick, the meek, and the vulnerable. We are to care for all of our God's creation, all persons of the world. Nothing should keep anyone from knowing Jesus, from being loved and cared for through that love. Today, as I said in announcements, is Worldwide Communion, a special day where Christians throughout the world share in this sacred meal. The rich and the powerful of the Americas, the meek and the mild of the lower middle class, the poverty-ridden communities, people in developing countries, people in war-torn countries. We are sharing this meal with our siblings in Christ throughout this world. This includes all those who are vulnerable in our world and in our community. I know I shared this last month when we celebrated communion, but it doesn't hurt to be reminded. I know myself, I need to be told about 6 times before I might remember something. This table that we are gathering around, this table that we will share this meal, and is a chance for all to receive a relationship with the community of faith. And for us as agents of Christ's love, to show that love and be that love into the world. We are open to all and we welcome all. I want to finish by sharing a sonnet by Malcolm Gait. Malcolm is a poet, priest, and chaplain of Gritton College, Cambridge. This sonnet is titled, "Whoever Welcomes." and is a response to the words of Jesus in Mark's gospel. Then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." Welcome. The word is always on our lips. Each welcome warms another one inside. An interleaving of relationships, an open door where arms are open wide. First, welcome to the child, and through the child, a welcome to the Savior of the world. And through the Savior's welcome, all are called home to the Father's heart. Each called is cured and nestled in another, as you were nested and nestled in your mother's womb. As Mary carries one, carries her, and as we are wrapped in you deep in the womb, where you turn our rejection into welcome, and death itself welcomes our welcome home. Thanks be to God. Let us join in song with Fairest Lord Jesus. When we come and offer ourselves to God, we offer many parts, including our tithes. Our tithes, our money, gifts are part of ourselves to celebrate and live into and support what this ministry is, this ministry of Port Elgin United Church, to share God's word into the world with the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Friends, the offering will be now received. gifts of the table, the cup, the loaf. Gifts in our hands are offerings through cash, check, and par. Gifts in our hearts, gratitude, humility, and faith. Receive and bless every gift that is given at this table and at all the feasting tables this Sunday. Amen.
And we
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give God thanks and praise. It is right to give God thanks and praise. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, we join with all your people throughout the world today to give you thanks and praise. You formed the universe in your wisdom and created all things by your grace. We praise you for all your good gifts, the witness of saints and prophets, the work of faithful people, this earth in all its blessing and promise, and this bread, once scattered, now brought together and made one. In the hope that your people may be brought together from the ends of the earth into the reign of justice and compassion, we gather with those of every time and every place to give praise and glory, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Mighty and tender God and Jesus of Nazareth, we recognize the fullness of your grace. Light, life, and love revealed in words that comfort and confront and comfort us. In teachings that challenge and change us. In compassion that heals and frees us. And now we gather at this table to remember and to be filled with such longing for your realm that we may rise together and turn our worship into witness and to follow in your way. We remember that when Jesus ate with his friends, he took the loaf, and after blessing it, and he broke it and gave thanks, saying, Eat, this is my body given to you. Each time you do this, remember me. Then he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he passed it around with his friends, saying, Drink, this cup is poured out for you and on my promise of God made in my blood. Whenever you drink it, remember me. At this time, we also remember all whom we would have share with us in this meal. We pray for all who are in sorrow or in pain, all who are ill or alone, all who live with fear, oppression, or hunger, all whom the world counts as last and least. We pray for the church and its varied ministries, for nations that they strive for peace and justice, for all our families and friends. Loving God, we rejoice in the gift of your grace, remembering Christ's life and death, proclaiming his resurrection, waiting in hope for his coming again. Grant that in this praise and thanksgiving we may so offer ourselves to you that our lives may proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Send, O God, your Holy Spirit onto us and onto these gifts, that all who share in this loaf and this cup may be the body of Christ, light, life, and love of the world. In this hope and in your people, we praise you, through Christ, in Christ, and with Christ. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, in glory, all glory is yours, God, most holy, now and forever. Amen. Friends, Jesus Christ, the bread of life. Friends, Jesus Christ, the cup of blessing. The gift of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Oh, you're Karen, that was fine. You were leading us. Just a reminder, those, we come down the middle. So if you're in the middle two sections, come to the center, come forward, go to the side that you'd prefer. If you're on the outside, go to your aisle, back outside, back in. Greg is going to offer the worship team, and anyone who chooses not to come up. So if you stay in your pews and want to receive, give a little wave at Greg and he will serve you. Friends, come, for all is now ready. order of them, and then we'll serve you last. Christ, the bread of life. Break, Jesus Christ, the cup of blessing. Please join me in our prayer after communion. Life-giving God, may we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring new life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so that we and all your children shall be free, and all your creation will live to praise your name.